Tēnā koto, te whānau, o Auckland Unitarian. Tēnā koto, nā manuhiri. Nau mai, haere mai. Ki tenei, whare karakia o te atua. Tēnā koto, tēnā toto, katoa. We welcome you into this space made sacred by Auckland Unitarians for 119 years. I'm John DeLeo, one of the congregation's worship associates. It is my honor to lead this morning's service. If this is your first time here, or your 101st time, we are glad you are here. If you carry the weight of a weary world on your shoulders, or you entered through the doors with a song in your heart and a skip in your step, we are glad you are here. If you are the loudest voice in the town square, or the subtle hand behind the scenes, we are glad you are here. If you have failed once or 1,000 times, we are glad you are here. If you sing like angels or mumble behind the hymnal, we are glad you are here. This community is what it is because of your presence. So welcome. Welcome into this space of love, support, justice, compassion, fellowship, and worship. We are glad you are here. I want to extend a special welcome to those of you who are viewing this service on YouTube, either the live stream this morning or the recording afterward. After the service concludes, let those of us here in person join together for morning tea. It is our sacrament of hospitality. Please join us. It won't be the same without you. Over the next 20 hours or so, in small towns and big cities, in single rooms and ornate sanctuaries, many of our sibling Unitarian Universalist congregations will also be lighting a flaming chalice. As we light our chalice this morning, let us remember that we are part of a great community of faith. May this dancing flame inspire us to fill our lives with the Unitarian Universalist ideals of love, justice, and truth. Please join me in reciting the covenant of our church, which can be found in your order of service. Love is the doctrine of this church. The quest for truth is the sacrament, and service is its prayer. To dwell together in peace, to seek knowledge in freedom, to serve humankind in fellowship, to the end that all souls shall grow in harmony. Thus do we covenant with each other and with our God. Please now stand, if able, and join in singing Spirit of Life. And now it's time for a time for all ages. I would be really grateful if all the children with us today could join me up front. Oh, wait. Today, I'll be reading Red, a crayon story. Clay has read this story a few times, so many of you are probably familiar with it. I'm reading it again today because it carries a message that's relevant to the topic of our upcoming conversation. He was red. While there are lots of different conclusions we might draw about the point of this story, I wanted to highlight one in particular. In this story, the main character was struggling to live up to their label and what the label caused those around them to expect. But in the end, they are what they do. And their actions define them more truthfully than any label ever could. Now I invite all of those present to come forward and light a candle and share your joys and concerns with us, or simply to come forward and light a candle in silence. And as a reminder, in case this has any effect on what you might choose to say, remember that we are being live streamed.
Right, well, I'll come in. My name is Paul. As you can imagine, sorting all this live stream stuff has been quite a concern over the past few weeks. But I think it's slowly turning into a joy, so I'm quite happy about that. And we're like, well, it's like no promises, you know, because one day something works and then suddenly the next day it doesn't. And it can be a little disconcerting. But here's a candle for it anyway, I hope. There was something else I was going to say, but it's probably more by way of an announcement. I'll say it later.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Alex. I'd like my candle to say thank you to John. As that story unfolded, gosh, I recognized myself. I lived under my label until my 50s. And the last 30-odd years have been really, really good. Good. I'd also like to light another candle. Quite a few of you here know Terry Robinson. I visited him on Christmas Eve. And he stays mostly in bed now. He's 92. And he's lost his hair. He looks a bit different now. But that's all right. He's able for a chat, still thinking, still wondering, still talking about all the important things of life. It's really fascinating. If any of you think of going to see him, it would be lovely. Leo has visited him, and he's still talking about that. It was a lovely visit for him. Thank you, John.
Well, I'm David, and I'd like to light a candle of joy for some of the dogs that I met over Christmas. My dog has been blind for a couple of years, and this year he's even worse. He's got an infection in one of his eyes, and we'll probably have to have it taken out. And so he's wearing a hood, which looks exactly like Rachel's hat, except it's worn the other way around. It comes out this way so that she can't bite the stitches on her eye. So she's had it in a terrible state. But she is so happy about it that everybody commented who met her. We We had a Christmas Day party with four families with dogs at a beach on the North Shore. And would you believe it's right at one of the most beautiful beaches on the North Shore, and there's nobody at it except for these four families and their dogs all running around. The most happy event. And our dog was as happy as any, despite being blind, chasing other dogs around the beach. Amazing attitude, that dog.
Hi, I'm Leo. This is a joy. So we got a call from Jenny's niece in Vancouver. It was lovely to hear her voice, though I took a while to understand her because her Canadian accent is getting stronger and stronger. Had a sort of a late night, and we sort of slept in, and I was half awake when she rang. But yeah, it's a joy. It was lovely to hear her. They're doing it tough though in Vancouver. They're in a high rise, and sort of two bedroom, and very confined. And if they have to put the rubbish out, they've got to wear masks and go down and put the rubbish in. They've got to change all their clothes, put different clothing on when they come back and wash it. So it's very tough over there, that's for sure. But it was lovely to hear from her. And she's got two children. Oldest, 15, and he's nearly my height. Last time we saw them, just we fellas. But it was good. Good to hear from them.
Hi, I'm Corrine, and my candle is a candle of gratefulness for all the frontline workers this year, the ones at the food banks, the ones hearing all the stories of distress. One of those is a very dear friend of mine, Daryl Evans, who's the CEO of Mungaree Budgeting, who's quite often on TV and on the radio. And he was talking to him on Wednesday, and he said the last few weeks all his staff are just breaking down because nobody who comes through their doors has a happy story. So I'm hoping that they all get a really nice break for a few weeks because they really are on the front line and see some very sad things.
I know it's been a while, but I'm Clay. And this is just a candle of Christmas joy. Christmas Eve, thanks to so many of you who helped make it happen, was just a joy for me. After, I'm trying to remember if that's the sixth or seventh Christmas with you, but I think we finally got it right. But my favorite was, I got a picture sent to me by Gary and Brenda, and it was taken from within their camper van with their computer and me standing up there leading Christmas Eve worship in a camper van somewhere. I don't know my geography well enough, but it was in the sticks somewhere. So it's been a treat, a joyful holiday.
Well, first I want to express what's both a joy and a concern, and it's related to what Leo mentioned. It is a great joy that we were able to spend Christmas Eve together, and that many of us were able to go and enjoy time with friends and family together on Christmas Day.
So it was a joy for us. At the same time, it's a concern for all of those who couldn't do the same, and for the emotional and psychological harm that it's doing to have that isolation be going on for so long. In one case, Tessa's mother, due to the fact that she has pre-existing conditions that put her at high risk, has been basically a shut-in since March. And at this point, there's still no end in sight. So although we can be happy and relieved that things are going well here, it's always, it's a downer to realize that it's just not going that well elsewhere. And I light this candle to commemorate all those joys and concerns which we may hold in our hearts and which are left unsaid. Now please stand if able and join in singing our Koha hymn number 131. 131.
This morning, I've chosen as my reading The Beatitudes for Justice Builders by Lindy, Ramsden. Blessed are you who can question your own assumptions and listen with an open mind. You will receive new insights beyond your imagining. Blessed are you who suffer the attacks of others to stand up for what is right. You will not be alone, for your courage will inspire others to rise. Blessed are you who build friendships as well as justice. Even when you lose an issue, you will have strengthened the foundation of your community. Blessed are you who take delight in people. You will not be bored in meetings. Blessed are you who agitate the placid waters of complacency. You will create waves in the inertia of privilege and will know the thrill of riding the surf of change. Blessed are you who lead with enthusiasm and confidence, resisting the temptation to shame the apathetic and self-absorbed. You will inspire curiosity and hope in others. Blessed are you who play as well as work. You will have more fun, build more energy, and will draw the powers of the impish to your cause. Blessed are you who ask for help in your roles as leaders. You will find teachers at every turn, and your work will remain interesting and alive. Blessed are you who, when wrongfully attacked, find safe outlets for your righteous rage. Your mind will be clear, your decisions strategic, and your progress will not be derailed by the backlash of the fearful. Blessed are you who do not demonize your opponents. Your eyes and your hearts will be open. Blessed are you who sing and dance. You will find energy and joy to lift you on your journey. Blessed are you who offer thanks and praise fivefold for every critique. Your children will want to visit after they are grown. People will want to serve on your committees, and friends will be interested in your opinions. Blessed are you who study the rhythms of history. You will have knowledge with which to shape the future. Blessed are you who work in coalition rather than in principled isolation. You will meet great people, learn things you didn't realize you needed to know, and have partners for the journey when you are in the lead or in need. Blessed are you who volunteer to be secretary and take good minutes. Your words will become history, and your efforts will move steadily forward rather than running absent-mindedly over thoroughly discussed ground. Yeah, I resemble that one. Blessed are you who discover, train, and encourage young leaders. You will see your work expand and grow beyond your own time and talent. Blessed are you who can change your mind. You are still alive. Blessed are you who will not let the perfect be the enemy of the good. You will see progress in your lifetime. And because I never connected to the Wi-Fi, I don't have the next page. So Alex made the very fine point that folks without a grounding in the Judeo-Christian Bible might not recognize the term Beatitudes. So the Beatitudes, and I don't remember which gospel it's in. It's in one of the four gospels in the New Testament where Jesus is preaching basically on a beach, and he goes through blessed are. And so that's the structure here. Blessed are the so-and-so, for they will. So this is modeled after that and written by a Unitarian minister. Continuing. Blessed are you who will not let the perfect be the enemy of the good. You will see progress in your lifetime. Blessed are you with an active spiritual life. You will find perspective and comfort in times of loss and betrayal, and will rise without cynicism to meet the challenges of a new day. Blessed are you who live from a place of gratitude, for you will know the meaning of life. My musings today are, not surprisingly, about us. A few weeks ago, Nina Curry led our service, mentioning that she, Derek Hanley, and I have embarked on an inquiry regarding the future church. We've been asked to reflect on the current state of our community and ponder the possibilities for what it could be in the future. It occurred to us pretty much immediately that this isn't something we can go off and do on behalf of everyone else. Instead, we need to lead a guided introspection by the entire congregation. For any among us who have been involved in strategic planning in any organization, the themes we immediately recognized we would need to focus on are pretty familiar. Our identity, our purpose, and our vision of our future selves. Who are we as a community? Why do we exist as a community? And what do we want to become as that community? Pretty heady stuff. At a more tactical level, our thoughts have touched on things like how to maintain and utilize this space, what sorts of outreach and service we can, should, or want to do in the broader community, attracting and retaining new members, and our plan for future leadership. All of these have a common thread: sustainability. In short, how do we keep the Auckland Unitarians going and growing as a community? One thing I've learned the hard way over the years is that tactical initiatives cannot get us where we want and need to be if we don't know and agree on where that is. To know that, we must thoroughly understand our identity, purpose, and vision. Today, I'm going to continue the conversation Nina started about our identity. She asked us to ponder what makes this community home for each of us. Today's question is a bit different, but definitely related. What makes us us? In preparing for today's talk, I found a number of blog posts aimed at helping churches to define their identities. They had several elements in common. Here's an excerpt from one post's advice. Start by finding your congregation's point of difference. To do so, you need to take an honest look at your congregation. Not what you hope it might be, not what you think it is, not what you want it to be, what it is. With no prejudice, look at it through the eyes of an outsider, one who does not yet know you. I say without prejudice and as an outsider, because creating a fantasy land will only cause visitors to become disappointed, disenchanted, or worst case, disconnected. Now that your eyes are open, what makes your congregation different? The ideal distinction should come from your congregation's mission statement. If that's too general a statement, look deeper. Base it on your connections with the community. It could be the types of services you offer. It could be your youth or outreach programs. Whatever you determine that to be, it must be within the context of your congregation's overall mission, and it must speak to those outside of it. Once you've discovered your point of difference, communicate it consistently through each channel, each tool, and each network that you have at your disposal. Check to make sure your message is consistent on your website, social media, bulletins, signage, and in the way you and your membership interact with the community. Your logo should reflect this as well. End of that quote. In another post I found, the author puts forward 5 questions to ask ourselves in determining who we are and where we are as a church. So I'll read the question and then a short excerpt from his commentary about the question. What's the general makeup of your church body? Look at everything from racial makeup to primary language makeup to generational makeup. What kinds of gifts, talents, and experiences do the people of your congregation have? It's highly likely your church has more ministry potential than you can imagine. For example, an abundance of teachers in your church may show untapped potential for outreach into local public schools. Who are your ministers? Generally speaking, ministers best reach people their age or up to 10 years younger. Your ministers' ethnic, racial, and educational backgrounds also play a part in whom your church will best reach. What are some of your church's signature ministries? Ask yourself this question. If we were to close down every ministry in our church, which would be the last ones to go? Those are probably the signature ministries. What has your church done that has been fruitful particularly in recent years? This is connected to the previous question. The answer may be the same, but this will broaden your view. You may notice that preaching pops up over and over again. You may notice a specific event. Fruitfulness can be measured in many ways, but it will generally be connected in some way to the creation of new members. In her thesis, "You is the Church, Identity and Identification in Church Leadership," Megan Gessler, a 2013 master's graduate from the University of Montana, raised several interesting points that resonated with me and are pertinent for today's topic. I'll quote a few here. "There are expectations regarding the process of becoming and the practice of being a member of a church. Members of a church leadership are different from most volunteers because they act simultaneously as clients, volunteers, and management. Church identity construction and enactment is believed to happen through individual action. The communication of the desired identity is necessarily discursive. Thus, there is a complex interplay of church identity and individual identity." That was very academic speak, I know. "Organizational identification includes a connection between individual and organizational identity construction through voluntary participation in church behaviors." This last point is, I think, crucial to the conversation I'm hoping we'll have today, and goes back to a comment I made earlier. We are what we do. Our weekly rituals, the external programs we host and support, the causes we involve ourselves in, our interactions with one another, the ways we choose to communicate to the broader community, those behaviors are the truest definition of who we are. Now comes the homework. I ask each of you to reflect on what makes us us, particularly to an outsider, a new visitor to our congregation. Understanding our identity as it now stands leads to some tougher questions. Is there a gap between what our identity is and what we want or believe it to be? What would we, as a community, have to do to bridge that gap? And if a change we'd have to make to align our actual identity with our desired identity makes me uncomfortable, then what can I do? And how can the congregation help me to gain peace with that change and continue to feel a part of the community? When I first started preparing this talk, I had planned to tick off a nice long list of things I believe about who we are, who we should be, and what has to change right now. But I realized that would be wildly counterproductive. I certainly have a lot to say on the matter, but that's just one member's perspective. To progress in our journey toward a shared, meaningful, and sustainable identity, we have to understand and consider everyone's perspective, honor their truth, and approach change and growth in a loving manner. That's not to say the journey will never be painful. It's crucial, though, to acknowledge, respect, and do what we can to minimize that real pain. Here endeth my preaching. So we're going to bring the service to a close and then come back to those questions in our discussion. So as we come to the end of our service, please stand if able and join in singing our closing hymn, number 318.
Thank you.
Please join me in saying our words as we extinguish the chalice. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of movement. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again. That most wonderful time of the day is upon us. Are there any notices?
All right, Paul.
Hi. And it's really the concern that couldn't quite remember before. But from the camera there, all the seats that get shown to the outside world are the empty ones at the front. Which is not a good look, guys. We may need to start a roster for people to sit in the front two rows.
That was an excellent suggestion. We'll start off with just two rows of seats. You get to have a back row once those are filled. We might also need to leave this one corner chair out. I think it might be in the line of sight. Other notices? David?
I'm the unfortunate person to take the first two services of the new year. But I forgot to put the names of the subjects in the bulletin. So the first one for next Sunday, which do you prefer, the Jewish Garden of Eden or the Christian one? It arises from a conversation I had with a Jewish woman. If a Buddhist and an atheist are fighting for the last car park space, who will win? That arrives from an argument I had with a Buddhist in the car park.
It's always good to choose those speaking topics from personal experience. Do we have other notices? Okay, well, I also want to give a big vote of thanks to Paul for struggling through figuring out the live streaming. And I was very happy to be part of the Christmas Eve service, and it was great to see so many of you there. And with that, we will proceed to close. After we close this morning, I ask that you stick around, form into small groups, and discuss your thoughts on today's discussion question. I was planning to hand out some slips of paper. Okay, we didn't get a chance to prepare those. So I'll try and gather up some paper while we're talking, because I would really love for you to write down your individual answers, anonymously, of course, including those follow-up items that I brought up. So the primary question is, if the world could know just one thing about us as a community, what would you want that to be? And the follow-ups are about that first answer. A, do you feel that thing is true about us right now? And B, if not, what should we be doing to make it true? My closing words today are by Richard S. Gilbert. As we leave this community of the Spirit, may we remember the difficult lesson that each day offers more things than we can do. May we do what needs to be done, postpone what does not, and be at peace with what we can be and do. Therefore, may we learn to separate that which matters most and that which matters least of all.